Well, here we are this morning. I got up early, came out here and started working on some fish here. Been actually cleaning a big old amberjack. Call these things rubber lips.
Yeah,
or a reef donkey. They're called reef donkeys for a good reason.
Yeah, yeah. A lot of people badmouth amberjack. Just for the fact, to be honest with you, I have traveled, you know, you and I have traveled up and down the East Coast, the Gulf Coast, and North Carolina, the Carolinas, are the only place that people don't like amberjack. And the only thing I can figure is that people don't like them because there's so many of them that they think they're just, since they're so easy to catch, they must not be worth anything.
It's kind of interesting. It's almost a cultural thing, you know, with where you travel on the coast. Like in a lot of places, people won't even touch or look at a king mackerel.
That's right. They hate them.
But you come here and people love to eat a king mackerel. Yeah. So it's really kind of funny just where you go. But thankfully we travel a good bit. And so we don't waste a whole lot of fish. And, you know, here this morning, like I said, cleaning this fish, and we've got the Wing and Fish Company in Shallotte. And basically when we go fishing, we go grocery shopping.
Right.
And, you know, we caught some amberjack, and you can see how just firm and pretty this meat is right here. I mean, you know, this fish actually, if you were not an honest restaurateur, this passes as grouper a lot.
Right, right.
But, you know, we certainly don't do that. But we, you know, we serve amberjack there from time to time when we have it. And it is just firm and white, and it's delicious.
Well, yeah, another thing about amberjack beside being good to eat is they pull.
Oh my God.
They call them reef donkeys. I think that's just because they're stubborn. I think it's the stubbornness. They are, besides a tuna, which I would say is, you know, considered the strongest fish in the ocean. I mean, I would put an amberjack. If you tied a tuna and an amberjack together, it'd be a dead pull-off.
Yeah, I mean, pound for pound, they're probably one of the toughest. But, yeah, I mean, you hook one of those things, and it is just, you know what I love doing most is when we take folks fishing that don't get to go very often, and, you know, they're used to maybe catching brim in the pond or bass or whatever, and you drop one into amberjack's mouth and hook him up, and he doesn't know what's just happened.
Yeah,
and,
charter fishing here out of the fishing center. This is one of our staples. They're a very important fish to our business for the exact same reason. We have lots and lots of people who don't go a lot, so they don't get to see them. You pull up on a wreck, and they are prolific. They come up to the boat like gold, like carp eating, you know, pellets off the top of the water at the pond, and you start throwing live baits to them. Literally, you can hand feed them at times. They get so aggressive. Reminds me, remember, I mean, we've done it a lot, but we got a good some good footage a while back of some amberjack fishing. So let's cut away to that and let the folks see what it's really all about.
Let's do it.
Come sit on the seat,
Jack. Bow hook,
Jack.
Hey, Jack.
Put it in neutral. Okay, this fish is coming up. Pretty sure it's an amberjack. He bit our deep line. Yep, I see him there. Man, what a fight.
That was a good fight, Garrett. Good fight.
These fish are super strong. Not exactly what we were hoping for, but we needed some activity. It's been a tough day for white fishing, truthfully. We have worked at it hard. Pulled one off, caught one.
Made a 70 keeper, okay, Bert?
Great, let me get in there, Bubba. Big old amberjack.
Big one.
Call them rubber lips.
That's
they will bite a troll ballyhoo.
Mom,
try
dropping this in the food.
Don't hurt.
You're very upset.
We're gonna make fish, smoke fish out of this one, or are we gonna let him go?
Yeah, no, these are super good fish to use for smoked fish dip, so he's gonna find his way to the dinner plate.
Yeah, real good smoked fish.
40 pound amberjack.
It's very soft.
All right. Get you this off. Does that mean your speed?
Aggressive power brand.
Just remember how we showed you using that song to press the line against the press a little bit to help you raise it?
Yeah.
You can get a little bit. Caitlin, because she is wore out, but unfortunately we have caught an amberjack here and not a king mackerel. I'm sorry, Caitlin, that was a good job.
Fishing is brought to you by There's no better place than the one you call home. It's where memories are made and futures are planned. Doesn't your home deserve the right protection? Stop by or call Allstate agent Rusty Russ at 910-754-6596 to talk about home insurance today and let the good life in.
Yeti coolers are built to take the rugged abuse that comes with the way we work and play. These grizzly-proof ice chests are virtually indestructible. With thicker walls, more than twice the insulation, they outperform the competition. And keeping things cold is what Yeti Cooler is all about. Yeti Coolers. Wildly stronger, keep ice longer. Marine Service Center of Little River, offering sales and service for Yamaha, Contender, Pathfinder, Hughes, Maverick, Carolina Skiff, and other top-of-the-line brands. Visit us online or off Highway 9 outside of Little River.
Fulford Heating and AC is a third-generation family-owned company going on our 40th year servicing Brunswick County. We have been voted Brunswick County's best HVAC company 5 years running and tops in customer service. Fulford Heating and AC has been selling warmer winters and cool summers since 1974.
That's what you call hand feeding them.
Yeah, that is a hard-fighting fish. Prolific here off the Carolinas. We've traveled everywhere. I think there are more and better amberjack fishing here than anywhere.
For better or worse.
Yep, so, for better or for worse. For us, I think it's better.
Yeah, I agree. But this is probably a good opportunity. We're kind of making this show as we go. Let's make this show all about fish that pull hard.
Yep.
And we so happened to have been recently offshore and did some deep dropping. And looked into some snowy grouper and golden tile fish, and talk about pulling.
Yeah, those are two great fish, but also some fish that just, you know, nobody really knows much about is the golden and the snowy.
Let me stop you real quick. I'm going to go grab a fish, and
okay.
Then you keep talking about them.
So our tile fish and our snowy grouper are deep water fish, and traditionally people like to grouper fish Oh man, look at that one. That's a pretty fish. That's a tile fish there. Traditionally, people fish bottom fish, you know, inside of 150 feet, normally inside of 100 feet. But this fish and the snowy grouper that we have come from no less than 600 feet of water. And these are bottom-dwelling fish. This happens to be called a golden tile fish. Look at that crazy little, that's his goozle, we call that. But I'm telling you what, it is one of the most incredible fish to eat. That is hands down my favorite fish. I will eat tile fish beyond anything. It is my favorite. And the same, you know, they mix in with the snowy grouper we were talking about.
Yep.
And they pull exceptionally hard.
Yeah, I mean, this is just such a neat fish. I mean, really, this is something we discovered here in the past couple of years. We haven't been fishing for these very very long. But, man, I mean, look at this fish. It is beautiful. I don't know how well it's showing up on camera, but it is just spotted yellow. You wouldn't think a fish that lived in 700 foot of water, you know, would be this pretty. But, man, it is just awesome when this fish comes up from the depths. And they hold their color really well. You know, a lot of times you catch a fish, you put him in the cooler, and you get back, and he looks like he's, you know, he's had a tough time, but this fish is you know, stays pretty. And like you said, I will tell you right now, we are, you know, we are extremely experienced fish eaters.
Right.
There is no fish that I have ever come across that is like this fish. The texture, the taste, I don't know what it is about them, but man, it is unreal. And whenever we get a chance to have these at the restaurant in Shallotte, you know, we jump all over it. And I don't think that the folks probably understand, you know, the delicacy or appreciate it.
They don't appreciate how hard they are to catch. I mean, we have to go 100 miles.
Yeah.
When we leave the dock here, the Ocean Isle Fishing Center, we travel 100 or, you know, no less than 90, I'll put it. And normally it's 100 miles straight offshore here of Ocean Isle Beach, you know, ranging anywhere from, you know, from the Cape Fear area down to Georgetown. And we go out there and we have to search them out.
Yep.
And
tell me about your rig there.
Yeah, so this is, you know, catching them isn't that much rocket science. We actually use rigs like this. You can see there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 hooks on this rig. Notice the little glow beads right here. That's these little green things. So they get charged with light when they're in the sunlight. And then when you drop it down, you can imagine 600, 700 plus foot of water. You know, it's pitch black dark. So we throw squid, honestly, anything that stinks on the hooks. And I think they see the light, and then they get close to it, and they smell it. And I'm sure, you know, they're opportunistic feeders down there. They're just looking for something.
Yep.
But here's the best part about it. This is what we use for weight.
Yeah.
All right, that's a 6-pound downrigger ball right there. So you got to drop. It takes, literally, when you put the reel out of gear to drop down, You can go get a sandwich and drink a Pepsi. I think we've timed it. It takes generally around 3 minutes for the weight to get all the way down to the bottom. And then when you get a fish like that on and have to bring it up, that usually takes 15 minutes or so.
Yep.
So
yeah. That's kind of the, you know, we say they pull hard and they certainly do, but I will admit, we're not the toughest people on the planet that sit there and pull these things up by hand from 800
no,
feet.
No, I crank all mine by hand.
Yeah, I'm sure. But, no, you know, we get out there, we have to use electric reels. We're fishing so deep, and the weights are so big, and the fish are so big. You drop it down there, you kind of just watch that rod tip, and when it gets a bite, you know, you press that button, and, man, it's like you kind of just back away. At least I do. I'm a little worried. I'm like, I don't know if this is going to hold up.
Something's going to break. That rod's bending hard, and the fish is pulling so hard.
And it's kind of interesting. You can always tell when you have a golden tile fish versus a grouper. A grouper is going to bite. He's going to fight for the first 15, 20 feet off the bottom. But that golden tile, he's going to fight all the way to the top, and that rod will be just bucking, going back and forth crazy. And like I said, you're just waiting for something to break. But
right.
You know, that's why you got to use real heavy tackle.
Yeah. Do you happen to have one of the snowies still in
the box? Yeah, I'll grab a snowy.
So just a little bit more about the fish, and what we're looking for is we're traveling offshore, deep water, 600-plus foot of water generally. And from there, we look for bottom structure, honestly very similar to how we do, you know, fishing for gag grouper and scamp grouper and snapper, you know, in 100 foot of water. If you look for, you know, for mounds, rocks, ledges, and they are out there, you better have a good bottom machine to see them. But this is a snowy grouper here. Now, you'll notice his eyes immediately. That looks a little, you know, gross, but that's because we're bringing them from so deep, it blows their eyes out of their head. But again, extremely good meat, white, flaky, exceptionally good. And, you know, they're out there. Now, before we go too far and get folks too excited, there is one thing, you know, we certainly need to mention the regulations and the strictness on these fish. We are fortunate in that, and we, you know, sorry, I guess we prepared ourselves to be able to catch these fish by having the permits.
That's right.
And, you know, you know about the permits. They're very highly regulated.
Yeah, well, you know, we have the restaurant, so, you know, we do not encourage people to go break any rules, break any laws, and also kill fish that they're not going to eat.
Right.
You know, every fish that we catch is getting eaten. It is going to the restaurant. And, you know, you got to have the permits in order to keep these fish. I think maybe the regulations are you're allowed to keep, if you do not have permits, if you're strictly recrecreational fishing, you can keep one snowy grouper per day, I think.
Right.
And I don't even know what the golden tilefish is, but I think it's something similar.
Right.
And, but, you know, with the way that we've prepared ourselves with our permits, you know, we can catch more than that and are able to bring a good bit
right.
of fish home.
Yeah. Yeah. So that's, you know, something. Don't get too excited out there and think you're going to go clean up. They're hard to catch, you gotta go a long way, but they are extremely regulated. The good news is you can get them regularly at the Wing and Fish Company in Shallotte because we get to go catch them and serve them up, and you serve them up to the folks there. So,
yeah.
But, you know, one thing, you know, we catch a lot of fish and we show people catch a lot of fish, but we don't often actually display cleaning the fish.
That's right.
And so this would be a good opportunity to show, you know, technique on cleaning these fish. And most fish that you fillet, the technique is fairly similar. If you could see right here, can you turn it around a little bit? What Barrett's doing here is that he's going right down the backbone, and he's trying to, you see the backbone's right in here, and he's filleting the meat straight down the ribs and the back and pulling it right off of the fish. So that is step one, is to fillet it that way.
Yep, that's right, and you know, when you have a fish that's this tough to get,
right.
You want to make sure that you take complete and full advantage of every piece of meat that's on this fish's body.
Right.
And that's what we call the yield, which is how much edible meat can you get off versus what's left of the fish.
Right.
And so, you know, I'm very specific about cleaning these fish. As a matter of fact, I don't let anybody else clean them because
right.
I want to know that I'm getting every single piece of good eating fish off of here. And, you know, like you said, we're going to just cut right down the backbone there. Just kind of ease it through there, just peeling it off.
Yeah, one thing most of what we know, we, you know, is foundation from our father, Captain Rube the Guru, and he is our fish cleaning specialist when he's in town.
Yep.
And he always says that when you get done cleaning them, you should be able to read the newspaper through the skeleton, that it should be so thin that you can see right through it.
Yeah, that's right. But we'll get a good pile of meat off this fish. This fish probably weighs, what, I don't know, 25 pounds, maybe,
yeah,
something like that?
I would say in the 20s.
So these fish, it seems like we get about 50% yield, maybe, which means we're going to get around 12 pounds or so of actual meat off of this fish.
Yeah. And while we're doing this, you know, we've referenced the restaurant in Shiloh, your restaurant there, the
right.
OAFC Wing and Fish Company. And you know, one of the premises that you've helped to establish and build the business on is the fresh fish there.
Right.
And, you know, basically, if we don't catch it, you don't have it, then you're not going to sell it there. So we don't, you know, we're not going out to a mass fish market and buying quantities of fish. We are literally, this is what we call day boat fish, which
right.
is fish that are caught and brought back to the dock the same day. So, I mean, and there's nothing wrong with fish that aren't. But we keep our eyes on these fish. We know how they're treated from the time they come out of the water until the time they go on the plate.
That's right.
And so, you know, so that's what's important. And and the fact that it gets missed is that this is not easy. I mean, you know, people think it's all fun and games catching fish, but it is hard work, and it is not easy to be able to put fish on the table for folks to enjoy. We enjoy seeing people enjoy it, but it is not easy.
No, it's not. And on that note, thank goodness we also have chicken wings.
Yeah. And thank goodness you have good wings.
Yeah, because, you know, we can't catch fish every time. I mean, sometimes we go, they don't bite. Sometimes the weather's bad for
right.
multiple days and we don't get to go. So, you know, some folks come to the restaurant are disappointed that we don't have fish. And, you know, the explanation is if I didn't catch it, if it's not fresh, if it didn't come from right here, we're just not going to have it. And,
right.
you know, that's why we have other types of food there. So when we do have fish, you're guaranteed that it is going to be just as pristine and the best it can possibly get.
That's right.
But anyway, so I'm going to finish up this fish here, and I got a whole cooler full of them back here behind us, and you know, we should be eating these for dinner tonight, I'd say.
I will be your first customer standing in line. I can't wait.
All righty. Well, good deal. Well, let's take a break, and when we come back, we'll talk about the fishing report.
Sounds like a plan.
No Limits Fishing is brought to you by... There's no better place than the one you call home. It's where memories are made and futures are planned. Doesn't your home deserve the right protection? Stop by or call Allstate agent Rusty Russ at 910-754-6596 to talk about home insurance today and let the good life in. As a business owner, it's important for you to understand what you're making and what you're spending. At First Bank, we believe education is key to any financial endeavor, and we pride ourselves in collaborating with businesses. Visit localfirstbank.com or stop by a branch for a free business banking review. Member FDIC, Equal Housing Lender.
Marine Service Center of Little River, offering sales and service for Yamaha, Contender, Pathfinder, Hughes, Maverick, Carolina Skiff, and other top-of-the-line brands. Visit us online or off Highway 9 outside of Little River.
Fulford Heating and AC is a third-generation family-owned company going on our 40th year servicing Brunswick County. We have been voted Brunswick County's best HVAC company 5 years running and tops in customer service. Fulford Heating and AC has been selling warmer winters and cool summers since 1974.
Well, that was some exciting action, and not only fun to catch, but much more enjoyable to eat even than that. But anyway, the fishing report. Let's talk about what's going on in our area and what we're experiencing. We're in early August, and it is hot.
It is hot. I mean, we are the doldrums of summer. You know, it's usually a lot of calmer weather, which is a good thing, a nice thing. The water is super, super warm right now.
Yeah, I think we went on the charter boats the other day. It was like 84 degrees.
Right, right. So right. You just kind of got to, you know, just like all times of year, really, you know, just monitor the conditions. Think about how you'd feel.
Right.
You know, when it
right.
gets real hot, my favorite place to go is air conditioning.
That's right.
So a fish is similar. You know, they're going to be holding more in deep water spots, you know,
right.
from if you're in the backwater, you know, fishing for redfish, they're going to be in deep holes. If you are fishing, you know, offshore, these fish are all moving deep.
Yep. Yeah. So depth. And of course, the depth is where you get cool. You know, you and I have done a good bit of scuba diving,
right.
and which has been something that's helped us to learn and understand fish a lot better, getting to see them, but also getting to be in the water and feel it. And so, you know, a lot of people, I'm sure, have heard of what you would call the thermocline.
Right.
And so at some depth, when as we've been scuba diving, and the fish, of course, feel the same thing, they, you know, you go down, and it might be 84 degrees on the top. It might be 84 degrees down 30, 40 feet. But at some point, there'll be a layer, and it will literally feel like you walk into an air-conditioner room, and the water temperature will usually drop somewhere between 10 and 15 degrees. Instantly.
Right.
And so by going, when we say they go deeper, they move the, for instance, king mackerel is a good example. During the heat of the summer, the king mackerel will move out of the shallower 50 to 60 foot depths, and a lot of times they'll take refuge in that 80 to 100 foot depth range, where they then have a stronger thermocline. So they generally, they're probably feeding, I think they come up into the hotter water to feed on the bait fish, but then they have that option to drop down and
right.
chill out, literally.
Yeah, exactly. It's we actually, you know, we fished a king mackerel tournament this past weekend, and we're very fortunate.
We did good.
We were fortunate, did very well, caught a 37.14 pounder. It was an awesome fish, just a little bit more. We needed just a little bit more.
Second place, we're very proud of it, though. Had my kids on board, Caroline and Braden, and Amy was with us, and of course, me and you. And,
right.
And we were excited and tickled for that.
Yeah, and you know, that was a good example. You know, it's been warm. So we decided that we would head offshore and fish deeper water, and that was where the fish was at.
Right.
And, you know, beyond the king mackerel, I got to mention, it was an exceptional day. The weather was perfect. Caught a big fish, second bait in the water. We were done by 8 o'clock.
Yeah.
And Braden, your son, four years old, he caught his very first billfish. He caught a sailfish.
That's right.
And, man, that thing was awesome. It put on a show.
Yeah.
It jumped. I bet it jumped 50 times, and Braden went to work. And, man, he was excited. I think more excited with the fact that he was going to be able to now get a sailfish necklace.
Yeah, he said, my birthday's coming. Can I get a sailfish or marlin necklace? And I've been telling him, you have to catch one. So what? Lo and behold, where we go, catch one. So before he even had the fish to the boat, he was ordering, he was on the internet ordering up this necklace.
Yeah, well, that's a special fish, and I'm glad that happened
for
us.
Yeah, it was enjoyable. But you know what August is? August is Shark Month.
It is.
Shark Month on the Discovery Channel, and we're fortunate here off of the Brunswick County coast that August is also our Shark Month as well.
You better believe it.
A fish that gets overlooked, well, maybe purposely gets overlooked by some folks, but as a charter boat captain and here at the Ocean Isle Fishing Center, we take, I would say dozens, but it's really hundreds of people fishing through the months of July and August. There is hardly much more pleasure you can bring to folks than to take them shark fishing.
Yeah, it's really neat because, you know, everybody wants to go catch a big fish.
Right.
Most of the times you got to go way offshore to catch big fish, but you know, the shark fishing is different, and I don't want to scare anybody at home, but it is a fact. When you go swimming at the beach, folks, you're swimming very near the sharks, okay? The sharks, we fish for them maybe a half mile off the beach at most. Yeah. Whenever you see the shrimp boats, that's where the sharks are going to be a lot of times, and
right. They're
in 30 foot of water or something like that, and they are plentiful here, especially in August.
Yeah, no, let's back up a minute because I don't want to scare people and anybody. I mean, you know, it's an extremely rare occurrence for there to be a problem, but the sharks that we have here, you're not talking about,
nah.
You know, man-eater type sharks where, you know, great big. We're talking, what we have here are generally black tip sharks. That's the most popular. We also have what's called a black nose, and occasionally we see what are called scallop hammerheads, I think. They're not the greater hammerheads, which are the giant ones. These, but all of these, the black tips, the black nose, the hammerheads, are generally in the 3 to 4 foot range. And to be honest, that's the perfect size, because if they were much bigger, then they'd be too hard to catch.
Yeah,
so.
Yeah. I mean, they're ranging anywhere from 30, maybe up to as much as 80 pounds, something
that's
like
right.
that.
That's
and
right.
It's like I said, it's an awesome fish to catch, especially on these charters, because we just go basically right out the inlet. You're on the fish. You can catch them on short trips, and it's not rocket science catching them, just drifting Spanish mackerel fillets or dead pogies or something like that.
That's right. What I tell folks are asking about them, I call them the poor man's blue marlin.
That's right.
Because you don't have to go 60, 80 miles or 100 miles offshore to catch them. You can literally go close. And the black tips, especially, which are a true sport shark, are, I mean, as close to really, I mean, you know, as a big game fish, they hit. They run, they peel line for hundreds or more yards. They jump.
Right.
They'll jump and air out and spin and then swim and do it again. And, I mean, it's awesome.
Yeah, exactly. Well, just to kind of finish up the fishing report, just we should mention on the inshore waters right now,
right. The
red drum fishing is very, very good right now. And, you know, I've not dialed in on that fishery, you know, as well as I am the offshore. But I see the charter guys coming back. They're catching lots of those. And they're also catching flounder, too.
Yeah, flounder. Well, Captain Jeff Williamson here at the Fishing Center, in the past week, he weighed an 8.2-pound flounder and a 6.3-pound flounder that were literally just 2 or 3 days apart.
Right.
So he's walking tall right now,
and
he should be, because those are exceptional fish.
Well.
But fishing is good. We're in the heat of the summer, but things are still happening. We're able to produce fish for folks coming from out of town. And, you know, we got to keep right on going, and then we'll even get better in the fall.
That's right. That's the game plan. We may, I don't know what's next, but shark fishing sounds pretty interesting. We may need to put that on the agenda.
Let's see if we can check it out.
All right.